the enemy of freedom has chosen to make this year the decisive one. He is striking out in a desperate and a vicious effort to try to shape the final outcome to his purposes.
The communists had launched a massive New Year's offensive late in January. Martial law was declared by South Vietnamese President Hu. For their endeavors, the Viet Cong paid heavily in men and materiel. But the destruction in South Vietnam was widespread. The situation caused grave concern in Washington. Yet through it all, during the next 29 days, the president would re-emphasize America's determination to stand fast in Southeast Asia and seek a peace with honor. The month began for President Johnson at the annual presidential prayer breakfast, February 1st.
What we pray for with all of our hearts is an end to war and to tyranny. We're fighting now, as we fought 25 years ago, to prevent any further expansion of totalitarian coercion over the souls of men. And we do all of this with a very deep sense of humility, recognizing our own fallibilities and our own errors, but with an equally strong belief that the cause of humanity cannot be permitted to lose by default.
Later in the day, the president conferred the Medal of Honor on Air Force Major Merlin Detlefson.
This is an afternoon when it's good to stand beside a man in uniform. He is a brave man, come to claim the honor that his courage has earned. He is also a spokesman for the courage of thousands like him that are protecting you and serving us in Vietnam at this hour. And these same men are matching courage with a careful and with a very precise restraint. They are the bravest, and they are the best of the men that we can produce. And none, sir, will do better service to their courage or do better service to our cause of liberty, our cause of freedom, our cause of compassion and understanding. None will do better service to that cause than you, sir.
Major Detlefson was given the nation's highest honor for neutralizing North Vietnamese missile and anti-aircraft sites after taking extensive damage on his own plane. As reports of the disruptions caused by the Tet Offensive continued to come in, the president began a series of meetings with top-level advisors to determine precisely what the American response should be. There was a growing fear that the North Vietnamese would mount a full-scale attack on the Marine outpost at Khe Sanh to bring a swift victory in the fashion of Dien Bien Phu. This concern increased when on February 7th, the advance base at Long Bay was overrun. Members of the Joint Chiefs of Staff assured the president that the American position at Khe Sanh could be held against assault. The pacification program had been severely curtailed due to the Tet Offensive. Secretary McNamara, in voicing the intelligence data of field commanders, stated that a second wave of attacks on the weakened cities looked imminent. Additionally, there was the situation with the captured intelligence ship Pueblo and its crew. Due to North Korea's belligerent stance, talks at Panmunjom aimed at an equitable solution of the problem had not as yet achieved their objective. In order to bolster American defenses and regain some of the battle initiative, the president ordered an emergency step up of reinforcements. At Fort Bragg, North Carolina, El Toro Marine Air Station, California, and later on board the carrier Constellation in San Diego Harbor, the president, with a saddened heart, sent more troops to the defense of freedom.
It is never easy for men to leave. It is never easy to ask men to leave home and happiness for duty far, far away. But the duties of freedom have never been easy. For your nation, for all of its people, those duties may become more demanding. The trials may become more difficult. The tests more challenging. Before we or the world shall know again that peace on this planet is once more secure. You, each of you, have a great role to play in this struggle. I believe, I know that you will serve the cause of freedom just as your forefathers served it. You will serve it with bravery. You will serve it with skill. You will serve it with devotion.
Before returning home, Mr. Johnson made a stopover visit to former President Eisenhower at his home in Palm Desert, California. The general received a full briefing on the Vietnam situation. A broader discussion of world events took place when British Prime Minister Harold Wilson officially called on the President February 8th.
Our two nations are as close as ever. Our two peoples are as determined as ever to master the trials of the moment and to move on to the triumphs of the future. That is what the Prime Minister and I have spent the day talking about. We have ranged around the world, reviewing our large responsibilities, drawing on our experiences, exchanging insights, giving and getting much of value.